Today on Hello World, we are sticking close to home for once. We're going to travel virtually down the road to Stanford University, where there's a research lab that is doing some really cutting edge work around AI technology, video analysis, and video manipulation. A group of researchers there have done some projects in things ranging from creating fake tennis players, versions of Roger Federer and Serena Williams that can play matches against each other. And they're also doing this crazy analysis of cable news where they've had an AI watch 10,000 something hours of cable TV news and find out which topics dominate, who's getting the most airtime between people like Trump and Biden. And so it's sort of these fascinating applications of the cutting edge of where AI and video meet. Some of it, I think, will blow your mind a bit and raise some difficult questions. And so with that, let's head off to Stanford University.
Most generally, you know, I'm a professor of computer graphics. And so my students and myself and colleagues like creating new interactive experiences that were never possible before. That's sort of our mission, what makes us tick.
I was on Twitter one day and I'm just scrolling through and I'm a tennis nerd. And so I caught a video of this thing of Roger Federer playing against himself at Wimbledon. And that obviously caught my attention since that's kind of impossible. So I started digging into it and I saw this is based on some video analysis and AI technology that you guys have been working on.
A lot of us in the world right now are really interested in different forms of generating, analyzing, or manipulating video. And so I actually think it was an idea from my colleague. He said, hey, you should take all this broadcast sports video that's around and make a really cool video game out of it.
Yeah, and just to sort of break it down, and you tell me if I'm like understanding this right, but you feed your systems all of this video, just the raw video of these matches being played. Each player that you're focused on, you're learning the style of play, what shots they're likely to hit.
We took two ideas that are out there in the real world. We took sports analytics, which all the leagues are doing all the time, and that they're analyzing video. And then we took a very basic idea from computer graphics circa 2000, which is if you want a character to do something, record them doing many things, and then mix and match a bunch of little video clips together. And we did use a number of modern deep learning techniques to really fill in some of the gaps.
I mean, obviously, like, deep fakes are a big concern with modern AI. Are there, you know, legit, concerns that could arise from something like this?
I think there are absolutely always legitimate concerns. But a lot of what we did was based on technology that existed 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
And I agree that there's an inflection point. You know, when it starts looking real, very realistic, there's great power that comes with that. But it is not a new thing.
Yeah. For a while, you're like, oh, wow, this is Roger Federer hitting the ball. And then every now and then you're like, oh, it moves kind of a little weird. I don't know if it's like glitchy is the right word. But then at the same time, I was like, you know, I play tennis video games and there was a realism to it that you don't see in a lot of those games. You could see that this is like maybe the future of where this stuff is going is like I could actually play a simulated Roger Federer.
I mean, absolutely. The next step going forward is working with folks that can give us access to a lot more video. Because we did what we showed with only two or three matches from both of these players. If you gave us a much bigger database and the next set of techniques, I believe we can generate a very compelling visual experience.
You guys do a variety of different projects over there, and you also have this project where you've done this really broad analysis of cable news, looking at both what is said by analyzing transcripts and also who is saying it, who's on TV the most between men and women, different pundits, you know, different people in the news like Trump and Biden, obviously.
We're taking an extremely large corpus of video. We have almost 24/7 broadcasts of CNN, MSNBC, and Fox News since 2010. So we have transcripts and we have video for all of those. It's provided by the Internet Archive. And what we've done is we've basically turned it into an enormous library. We've indexed it and we allow the public to search those transcripts as well as who is on screen. And so we're really excited to see how, if we give the public, whether that be media watchdogs, whether that be journalists, whether it be scholars or hobbyists, the ability to essentially search this library of who and what was on the news, we think that some very positive things might happen in terms of understanding what gets presented, who gets the opportunity to present it, as well as what biases or dispositions the various channels have.
And so I noticed, I mean, obviously, historically, there are watchdog groups that look at this sort of thing, but it's like a manual process, right? Some poor human has to watch endless hours of horrendous cable news.
That's correct. And the big difference here is that we have taken some very manual, painstaking labor by folks that want to understand what's being communicated and had a computer automate a lot of that labor.
One of the realizations that came out was an imbalance between male and female hosts. There's a lot more male hosts. One thing I was surprised about was that, I mean, Fox News has almost a one-to-one ratio between male hosts and female hosts. They had by far the best balance on the host side, but on the pundit side, they were, I think, the worst.
That's correct. And one of the things that we're interested in doing is that we all have sort of a narrative about what's going on in the world. And this is about putting data behind that narrative. And the conclusions sometimes are quite interesting.
I wanted to talk just a little bit about the nuts and bolts of how you guys put this together. Because one thing I did not realize, Amazon has this facial recognition tool that you can buy as a service.
What we are surfacing to the public are the results of Amazon's Celebrity Recognition Service API.
I'm excited to introduce for you a new service called Amazon Recognition Video, which does real-time and batch video analytics. We'll detect objects and faces and scenes.
It is a form of doing facial recognition at scale, which has been talked about and continues to be talked about at length in the media right now because it is an extremely controversial technology.
Amazon can scan your face without your consent and sell it to the government all without our knowledge, correct?
Yes.
Now, on one hand, that's what we are doing. We are running Amazon's face recognition software on every frame of the news for the last decade. But we think that this is an application of face recognition where the potential for harm is low. It is run only on individuals that have appeared on cable TV news. But we thought that the ability to audit what is going on the news was a positive use case. But we had to make a judgment, and the judgment we made was that the benefits outweighed the potential harms.
One thing, you know, I think is worth bringing up, which you guys address, the facial recognition, it does way better on kind of like white guys than it does on females, and it also has some struggles on gender, especially for people who, you know, might identify in different ways. Is that right? I mean, it's basically strongest on like white male pundit than anything else.
Most of these services have shown scientifically that there is bias in these systems. And so any conclusions that you take from automated machine learning analysis need to be inspected very carefully to determine if that bias is playing a factor in the results. Our goal is to create interesting new capabilities, tools for analysts or creators, tools for artists if it's an entertainment. And so, like any tool builder, like you want to use the best tool for the job. And when AI provides new opportunities and is the right tool for the job, by all means, we should use it. But we also look at it with some skepticism in that if we go back to the tennis project that we talked about earlier, most of the reason why that looks so good is because we took human knowledge of how tennis works and encoded it in the computer. And we use the AI to kind of fill in the gaps. But the main knowledge is still human. And I actually think when people stop doing that and rely completely on data or completely on AI to build systems, that's where stuff starts going wrong. You know, for better or for worse, computing has gotten very, very powerful in the last decade.
Yeah.
And there are amazing things that we can do with that power. And there are significant concerns and significant issues that that power is bringing to bear on all of society.
Yeah.
There's a lot of responsibility to think very thoughtfully about what we are doing and why.